What did Aboriginals encounter fighting in World War I? Did you even know that they fought in World War I? They had so many obstacles in their way, but they persisted through courage and determination to fight for their country. Approximately 1,000 Aboriginal men fought in the Great War, but have been forgotten. There were many Aboriginal men who signed up, but the Aborigines Protection Board intervened.
In 1916, the military recruiting depot stated that Aboriginal, half-caste, and men with Asiatic blood are not allowed to be enlisted. This includes all coloured men. It was in 1917 that half-castes could join the war, although they still needed a medical exam to prove they had a European origin. If they were full-blood Aboriginal, they needed government approval to leave the country.
One of those special Aboriginal Anzacs was Douglas Grant. He was born in the early 1880s in northern Queensland. His parents were killed in what was believed to be a tribal fight in 1887, along with most of his Aboriginal community. Douglas was rescued moments before death by Scottish scientist Robert Grant. Robert adopted Douglas and they moved to Lithgow in the Blue Mountains for Douglas' early life.
Douglas enlisted in the 34th Battalion in January 1916, but just as he was about to leave, the Aborigines Protection Board stated that he couldn't leave without government approval. He later enlisted again and set off on the 13th Battalion in August 1916. In April 1917, just 2 months after arriving in France, he was captured by the Germans in the First Battle of Bullecourt.
After Douglas's capture, he spent 2 months at France in the Wunstorf Prisoner of War Camp, which specialised for French and British colonial troops, which were mainly Muslims. During his time at the war camp, Douglas supervised Indian prisoners as a member of the British Health Committee.
22 months after Douglas's capture, he returned to Australia. He resumed his job as a draftsman when he returned. He then moved on to a job of a labourer in a paper factory and then in a small arms factory. He passed away in 1951 at the age of 65 due to a subarachnoid hemorrhage and is buried in Sydney Cemetery.
They shall grow not old, as we that are left grow old. Age shall not weary them, nor the years condemn. At the going down of the sun and in the morning, we will remember them, lest we forget.
The Wakefield Strikes was a part of history that tells us how strong the Aborigines really were. Did the Aborigines benefit from the Wakefield Strikes? Before we explain, we would like you to tell you about someone.
This is Vincent Lingari. He was an Aboriginal activist, as well as being a Gurindji elder. In his early life, he worked on the Wakefield cattle station, owned by Vestis.
In 1966, 200 Aboriginal stockmen were not paid properly and they didn't have decent working conditions. Vincent Lingari then decided it was time to fight back and led the men in a strike. The Gurindji Aborigines were the first community to get their land back by Commonwealth government.
The strikes went on for about 7 years. The strike started on the 23rd of August, 1966. The strikes ended in 1973.
Wakefield strikes happened at a cattle station 800 kilometres south of Darwin. They worked for a British pastoral company, Vesti.
The Wakefield cattle station was in a very rural area and was very hot. It is on dry land with very low vegetation. The buildings were small and spread out.
In 1985, there was a special handback where the Prime Minister, Gough Whitlam, pulled a handful of sand. He asked Vincent Lingari to put out his hand. The Prime Minister began to slowly pour the sand into his hand. This is what the Aborigines called the Wakefield Handback.
Overall, our main question was, did the Aboriginals benefit from the strikes? After the handback had finished, they got a lease of 3,238 square kilometres of land around the Wakefield station. This had been their land for thousands of years before European settlement.
Vincent Lingari, I solemnly hand to you these deeds as proof in Australian law that these lands belong to the Gurindji people.
The 1967 referendum occurred on the 27th of May. It happened throughout Australia.
In the referendum, there were two main ideas: to include or exclude Aboriginals.
In the years leading up to 1967, Aboriginals were discriminated because of the colour of their skin. They did not have the same rights as other white people. And being an Aboriginal meant that you could not vote in state elections, marry whoever you wanted to, live wherever you wanted to, and they couldn't even be guardians of their own children. And to make matters worse, they couldn't get the same work pay as white men. When some people heard of this, they thought it was unfair, and this matter was taken to the Holt government. The Holt government were divided, so they decided to give it a federal vote. The only problem was that Aboriginals and Torres Strait Islanders weren't allowed to vote. The final say was 90.8%. This was positive news for Aboriginals.
So in 1967, I was 23 years of age. I voted for the referendum, which was brought forward by the Holt government, and it was specifically for the purpose of looking after the Aborigines as a separate group so they could be legislated.
Who did the 1967 referendum affect most? The 1967 referendum mainly affected Aboriginals and Torres Strait Islanders. However, the whole nation took part in voting, if you were over 21 years of age. Lots of people were even involved in protests.
The 1967 referendum proposed changes on two parts of the Constitution. The first section was designed to protect all Australians but Aborigines, and the second section that Aborigines had was that Aborigines had different rights in different states, for example, social security and education.
To conclude, the 1967 referendum now means that Aboriginals have most of the same rights. 90.8% of Australia voted to change two parts of the Constitution, so Aborigines would be no different to any other citizen of Australia today.
Acknowledgement of Aboriginals today. The 1967 referendum was held on the 27th of May all around Australia. The referendum was about improving the rights of Aboriginals. However, they were still not permitted to do the following. The referendum didn't grant them citizenship, didn't give them equal rights, and didn't allow them to vote. But the referendum was about improving the rights of Aboriginal people by changing two of the exclusive acts in the Constitution. Parliament shall, subject to this Constitution, have power to make laws for the peace, order and good government of the Commonwealth with respect to the people of any race, other than the Aboriginal people in any state, for whom it deemed necessary to make special laws. Section 51 of the Constitution. In reckoning the numbers of the people of the Commonwealth, or of any state, or other part of the Commonwealth, Aboriginal natives should not be counted. Section 127 of the Constitution.
Good morning, Grandy Greg, and thank you for taking your time today to interview with me.
What did I vote?
What did you vote?
I voted yes.
And what did you vote yes?
Well, because Aboriginal people just like anybody else, and why not give them the vote? And the way democracy works is that each person, through their vote, evens out the, hopefully, or in theory, it evens out the government to govern for everybody.
Given houses, food, and clothing. But in doing so, they were made to give up their culture. They became lost. They didn't have a purpose anymore. They no longer needed to live off the land. They no longer needed to survive. A quote from Greg Walker. The government thought they were doing the right thing, but instead they destroyed everything. A quote from Greg Walker. The referendum was a huge success, with 90.77% of Australia's white population voting yes.
majority of Australia voted yes.
Well, I think because we were a society that an egalitarian society. A society which favours a fair go, not in the political meaning of fair, but in the real meaning of fair.
Conflict is now scarce between the Aborigines and the white people of Australia. But to this day, Aborigines are still treated second best.
This year marks the 50th anniversary of the 1967 referendum of Aboriginal rights. On May 27, 90% of Australians voted yes for the Commonwealth to create laws for Aborigines and recognise them in the census. Along with this, the 3rd of June commemorates the High Court of Australia's Mabo decision in 1992. This legally recognised that Aborigines and Torres Strait Islanders have an important relationship to the land. These two major events mark National Reconciliation Week, a week where all Australians can participate in our nation's journey of reconciliation. This year's theme is Let's Take the Next Step. Unfortunately, if we are to take the next step, there are some significant changes to be made. In 1996, Australians recognised that there was a difference between an Indigenous Australian self and a non-Indigenous Australian. On average, Indigenous Australians live 10 years shorter compared to non-Indigenous Australians. Due to this, child mortality rate is 1.7 times greater than the Australian population. The Mabo decision was a legal case held in 1992 that lasted for 10 years. This decision recognised that Aboriginal and Torres Strait Islander peoples had the right to this land, rights that existed before the British people arrived and can still exist today. Without this case, the land that Aborigines have had a major connection with for thousands of years would not remain. Eddie Mabo was a Torres Strait Islander who believed that laws on land ownership were wrong. Due to this, he fought for these laws to be changed. Eddie strongly believed that Torres Strait Islanders had a significant relationship to the land and that they deserved to keep it. Unfortunately, the Australian government believed differently. In 1981, he presented a speech at the James Cook University explaining about the relationship between Aborigines and Torres Strait Islanders and the Australian land. From here, thanks to the help of a lawyer who happened to hear the speech, the information was passed on to the High Court.